Okay, so yeah, so the course objectives for this whole 7-week series is, as you may know by now, we would like to let you guys know what Ensembl is, which types of data you can get in Ensembl, how you can navigate the browser, and how you can contact us and connect with the team. So those are the main objectives for this whole series. This is our schedule. Again, you may be familiar with this by now. We are halfway through the course, so today is the 14th of April, and I'm going to be talking about the variation resources that you can access using Ensembl, and also how to use our Ensembl VEP. It's one of our tools, one of the most popular tools within Ensembl. Okay, so for those of you who have been here before, you are familiar with the structure of our webinar. However, I've got a few newcomers. So for those who are brand new to the series, it will be helpful for you to know that the structure of this webinar is actually composed by three parts. So I'm going to give a presentation of the variation data in Ensembl, what is available, and I will also talk about the VEP tool, which is the Variant Effect Predictor. I will try to do some demos, some live demos here. And once this webinar is over, within the next 3/4 of an hour or so, you'll have the chance, if you want to go and do the exercises that the whole team have put together for you guys. So this is the structure for this next 45 minutes or so. And as always, please do ask questions, as many as you do have. So we do have this chat box on your training platform over there. I have muted all the microphones apart from my own. But yeah, please ask questions. So my colleagues here, both Emily, Ben, and Helen, they are all together here with me in this room, and they will respond to your questions as I go along. So, and towards the end of the webinar, so if there are still outstanding questions, I will try my best to answer those. But during the talk and my demo, please ask questions to Emily, Ben, and Helen. Okay, so again, this is just a summary slide to give you an idea of what are the features that you can get in Ensembl. We have looked at the gene models. You all know now that we've got protein coding genes, RNA-seq genes, and non-coding RNA genes as well. So all annotated by us based on biological evidence. You also learned with Helen last week how to use BioMart. So if you want to retrieve data from Ensembl, so there is this very cool tool called BioMart. So you just need to go through 4 simple clicks using your mouse, and you can get a huge table with data from Ensembl or a huge file containing lots of sequences that you can export from Ensembl. And there is plenty more that we are going to cover in the series, and today I'm going to be talking about variation. So this is the theme of our module 4, genetic variation within Ensembl. This is the outline for my talk. So I'm going to go through the different classes of variation data, the species we've got data for, and where this data comes from. I will show you some of the places using the browser where you can explore this data, so mainly from the location tab, gene tab, and there is something new to us we haven't seen before, which is the variation tab. I will also cover a little bit on phenotype data and population genetics. So you can also get those from Ensembl. And towards the end, I'm going to talk about the VEP, which is this rather popular tool that can allow you guys to annotate your own variants. Okay, so in Ensembl, when we think about variation or when we deal with a variation, we've got two main types of variation data. So on one hand, we've got something which is called large scale. It may be known by some of you as structural variants. So things that are typically larger than 50 base pairs. So things, for example, if you are comparing two genomes or even two different chromosomes within the same genome, so you can see loci that are duplicated perhaps, or deleted, or inverted, or translocated from one chromosome to another, or even the entire loss of a given chromosome. So those are all different examples of this large-scale type of genetic variation, also known as a structural. So we are dealing here with large things. On the other hand, we've got something which is called short scale. Those may be the most familiar to you guys. So things such as SNPs, which can also be known as SNVs, and indels, short indels. So when you're comparing two genomes, when you see mismatches on those sequences, so those are the single nucleotide polymorphisms, and perhaps also with the same comparison, you can see that one genome may have a deletion when you compare to the other, so those will be these small deletions that we are talking about, of one base pair, two base pairs, and so on and so forth, up to 50 base pairs. So if the deletions or duplications that we are looking into, if they are larger than 50 base pairs, we will classify them as large-scale types of genetic variation. So those are CNVs. So CNVs is a typical example of large-scale, whereas SNPs is a typical example of short-scale variants. So both of those types you can find plentifully in Ensembl. So what are the species we've got variation data for? So I seem to remember from my first talk that the majority of you guys were working in human, mouse, and some vertebrates. So yes, we do have plenty of variation data for around 22 species in Ensembl, and we've got plenty of variation data as well in Ensembl plants, protists, metazoa. We don't have variation data for bacteria as it stands. But if you are interested in vertebrates, yeah, you'll have lots of variation data there. And let's suppose here, let's just make a note that these two species here, and actually zebrafish as well, those are the three most popular species within Ensembl, and we do have loads and loads of variation data for them. So there is one team within Ensembl, the variation team, who look very closely and keep that data for you guys. And the main goal of that team, the variation team, is to understand those different types of variation data and how we can visualize them in the context of our genome. So that's the main goal of the variation team within Ensembl. So our variation data comes from everywhere, really. So it depends on the species that you are looking at or working with. So let's say a human and mouse, most of those types of data comes from DBSNP. From human, we've got a lot coming from the 1,000 Genomes Project. I'll mention that project in a bit. Structural variants come mainly from the cipher. We've got, again, lots and lots of GWAS experiments and data out there, such as this giant consortium. So this is just a screenshot, really, to tell you some of the sources of our variation data. But yeah, you're more than welcome to have a look at that URL over there. And find the full list for every single species that we've got data for in terms of variation. So what a variation team does, so they import the alleles from all those different sources, and also they import the allele frequencies providing those are available. And once they have that data in hand, so they will be able to annotate those variants using our tool, the VEP. So where can you view that data in Ensembl? Using the browser. So you can, for example, from the location point of view, you can search for a given genomic location you are interested in, let's say human, mouse, lines, and then you can turn on data tracks in order to show your SNPs or to show your structural variants. So variants that are short, of the short scale, or variants that are large, such as CNVs. So depending on the species you are working on, you may have to turn those tracks on, so you need to configure the page to do so. And again, some of those tracks may be on by default. So this depends largely on the species you are looking at. But nevertheless, as a general rule, in the location tab, you can indeed view variation data, and you can compare against the genes and transcripts that Ensembl does provide. From the gene point of view, so you can perhaps search for your favorite gene, let's say DMD, BRCA2, so you can land on a gene page, our gene tab, and you can get variation data which is gene-centric, is gene-specific. So you can have a table containing short variants, things such as SNPs, or you can also get a table containing larger structural variants such as CNVs. And from those two different tables, you can explore the data that we provide there for you guys. You can click around, and then you can get additional information if you want to. And especially for this first call, this first table here, you can also filter the table depending, for example, on the different classes of variants. So, for example, you may be interested in those that cause a change of the amino acid. At the amino acid level, so you can come over here and filter the table according to this consequence, which is called missense variant. And in addition to the location tab and to the gene tab, we also have something specific to the variation data, which is called variant tab. So as the name seems to suggest, so you can, it's a place where you can go and you can get variant-centric information. So again, you can come to Ensembl, you can search for a SNP ID, such as this one, or let's say IS123, and you can get all sorts of different types of information for that given SNP. So this can also be performed at the structural, for structural variants as well. So again, you can come to Ensembl and search for CNV or a larger duplication, and you can get specific information for that given region or that given locus. So we've got those nice visual icons here, so you can just click on them as you browse along. We also have a menu on the left-hand side. Again, they do mirror what you see here, so it's basically down to you whether you want to click on here, genes and regulation, or there. And one of the things that we can explore in the variant tab is phenotype data. So, for example, if I click on this icon here, so I'll be redirected to a page similar to this one here, and I can have a table containing all the known phenotypes or traits or diseases that are associated with this given variant. So in this case here, I've got only one association, which is breast cancer. So according, and this data come from OMIN, so it's one of the sources of our variation and phenotype data in Ensembl. And yeah, so it seems that there is an association between this phenotype and the variants that I'm interested in. You can also come to Ensembl and perhaps search for a trait or a phenotype such as breast cancer, and you can find all the different locations or features associated with that given phenotype. So, and you can even have a nice diagram, or you can have the karyotype view showing every single human chromosome in this example and all the different locations of variants that seem to be associated with the phenotype you searched for. So here I can have this nice karyotype view, and I can also have a table containing all the different SNPs, the different locations, the different studies where they have been reported, and all of those have been associated with breast cancer. And I can also have a p-value, a value that can give me some, so it can give you an idea how significant that association is between your variant and your phenotype. So we can go through that during the live demo as well. So this is regarding phenotype. So again, he is just out of those 22 species in Ensembl that we've got variation data for, perhaps 12 or so we do have phenotype data for. So it's not for all of them. But again, our most popular species are the three over here, and we do have a lot of data for those, but also including lots of farm animals. So if you're interested in pig and cow, for example, so you may want to get phenotype data from Ensembl. And this, again, is just to remind me of the different sources of this data. So the majority for human comes from the online Mendelian inheritance in man. There's a lot of data coming from the GWAS catalog, which is now based at the EBI, but also in collaboration with NIH. And for mouse, we do have a lot coming from this consortium here, the International Mouse Phenotyping Consortium. So again, it's just to give an idea of the vast range of sources where we get phenotypic data for, and that you can then browse using Ensembl. Okay, so that's about phenotypic data. We also have population data for variants in Ensembl, so mainly for human, but we do have a lot as well for mouse, and if you're interested in Arabidopsis and other plants, we do have population genetics data for those as well. So again, you should be in the variant tab, variant-centric information, and you can search, or you can click on that population genetics link here, or you can click on the icon there, and you can then get hold of the population genetics data we've got in Ensembl. And mainly that population data comes from those two major projects here, the HapMap and the 1000 Genomes project. There are many similarities between those two, so both of them wanted to assess the genetic diversity of human groups. They were looking at thousands and thousands of individuals. Basically, the main difference is that the HapMap was genotyping DNA samples, whereas the 1000 Genomes project, they were actually resequencing thousands and thousands of individuals all over the globe. So they were able to identify novel variants that had never been identified before. So yeah, so those are the main sources of our population data, in this case for human. So, and that's what you can get from Ensembl. So you can get nice, colorful pie charts such as these ones, so you can have an idea of the allele frequencies in different populations. You can also get hold of genotype frequencies as well. And again, just to highlight that, yeah, the bulk of this data comes from the 1000 Genomes project, but also HapMap here. And some of the individuals and populations may overlap between those two big projects there. Okay, so that's pretty much what I would like to talk about: variation data, phenotype, and population genetics. So before I move on to the VEP, which is our tool to annotate variants, I would like to perform a live demo, which perhaps will help you guys to have an idea how you can get variation data from Ensembl using the browser. So the idea here is a very simple exercise, really. So let's take this assumption that coffee intake is rather a worldwide phenomenon, so everyone in the world is drinking coffee, and I wonder actually if caffeine consumption is in our genes. So can I use Ensembl to find out the chromosome locations of all variants associated with this phenotype? Can I also find out through Ensembl what is the most significant variant which seems to be associated with this trait? What is the ancestral allele of this variant? Is it conserved in other mammals, let's say eutherium mammals? What is the most frequent allele of this variant in Great Britain? And finally, can you download this variant and also some of its flanking sequence, let's say 200 nucleotide upstream and downstream? And can you do so in a rich text format? So again, so let's see if we can find our way around the browser and if we can answer to some or hopefully all of these questions. So I'm going to kill my presentation now. And I'm going to bring the browser. So here we are, www.ensembl.org. And the first thing I'm going to do, I'm going to search for that trait, which is caffeine consumption. So I can type in as few as four or three letters, and I do have already an autocomplete here with some options. So this is really what I want, caffeine consumption. So I'm going to click on that one. So that will take me directly to a page showing that nice karyotype view with this visual representation of all the different locations of the variants that seem to be associated with this phenotype, caffeine consumption. So you can see some of them on chromosome 7, and I've got one variant on chromosome 4, 5, and so on and so forth. So those locations, they can give you an overview of the variants there, and also they give you an idea how significant the association is. So if you look closely at the different colors there, so the closer your arrow is to red, the most significant the association is, or the more significant the association is, and closer to blue, the least significant you can find the association there. So again, it can help you to focus on those that do have a higher p-value. So if I scroll down, then I can go away from my karyotypic view and I can view actually a table which may make more sense to us, or perhaps it can give us more fine details. So here I can get the actual IDs of all those different SNPs. I can get the actual location of those SNPs, and then perhaps genes that they have been reported to, the sources. So in this case, most of them, if not all, they come from the GWAS. Also, you can get their publication if you want to explore a bit more the paper. And here, most importantly, at the end, you do have something called this column called p-value, which provides you with the probability that the association is significant. So you may pay attention that actually we do provide the negative log of this p-value. So usually when we are looking into p-values, we are familiar with things such as 10 to minus 8, 10 to minus 20, and so on and so forth. So the smaller that number, the more significant that association is. But here we need to be careful. We do provide a transformation of that 10 to minus value. So we will be looking at the higher this number, the higher the probability of the association be true or significant. So you don't need to memorize this. If you hover over that column name, so we will give you the explanation what you should be looking for. So in this case, so I can, in this view, I can ask my two first questions. Yeah, there are a few variants associated with caffeine consumption, and I can find that the most significant one, according to this transformation of the p-value, is this one here. So I can now click on the variant itself, and then I can go to the variant-centric page. So let's do that. May take a little while, so here we are. So now we are looking at the variant tab, or the variation tab. And from here, again, I can explore it as much or as little as I can. So by clicking on that ID, I'm landing on this phenotype data page. So in addition to caffeine consumption, it seems that this variant is also associated with this coffee consumption. So again, caffeine and coffee are pretty much very similar there. But yeah, in this case, it may be associated with tea consumption. So I don't know. I may want to explore this a bit further there. But yeah, depending on the way on the ontology of those different phenotypes, so you can get all the different associations there for your given SNP. Okay, so from here, what I can do, I can go to explore this variant. So I'm gonna click on this link here, explore this variant. And we will be on what we call a landing page of my variant, which is this one here. So, and then I can click on those icons as I wish. So I think the third question was, what is the ancestral allele of this variant? So it's right there for you. You don't need to look much further. So the ancestral allele for this SNP is allele T. The two possible alleles are listed there for you. And this order is rather important, so if you're not too sure what the order means, again, hover over, you will see that T is the reference allele and C is the alternative allele. Both of those are reported on the forward strand for you guys. And this, we should always follow this rule, this is standard when providing the allele string, reference / alternative. Okay, so the T is the ancestral one. So I wanted to know now how conserved this allele T is in other vertebrates or other mammals. So I'm talking about conservation here, so I should look for this phylogenetic context. So again, if you hover over there, we'll tell you what that icon will give you. So let's click on this. We'll have, by default, an alignment containing primates. So this is where we found out that T is the ancestral allele, so basically by looking at great apes, mainly. But from here, from this drop-down menu, I can choose whichever alignment I want to investigate further. So I'm interested, according to my example, I was interested in Eutherium mammals, placental mammals, so I'm going to click on that option and then click on Go here. So a new alignment should be displayed there for us, so here we are. Of course, some of those species we may not, as you may remember from my talk, we won't have variation data for those, I'm afraid. But yeah, for providing we do have data for those Eutherium mammals, we will display on that alignment for you. So my variant is right here in the middle, so it's actually this one here. And so if you look across those different alignments or sequences, all of them, apart from pig, will have the T allele at that position. So yeah, so this T allele is ancestral. So we knew that information from my summary here, and we can see how far back the T allele can be observed in other vertebrates. Okay, so I think that's what I would like to cover in terms of phylogenetic context, and I think the other question I had, I'll just remind myself here. Yeah, what is the most frequent allele in Great Britain? So let's bring again my variant table, or variant tab. And then I'm going to click here on population genetics. And by default, I do have those nice pie charts with this what we call the superpopulations from the 1,000 genomes project. So we've got Africans. Again, you don't need to worry what the three letter code means. You hover over and we'll tell you what they are. And Great Britain should be under the EUR, the European group of populations. So let's expand that field over there. So here we are. And now I can see all my five different European populations that make up this supergroup here of Europeans. And my Great Britain is here. Again, so I've got British from England and Scotland, and the majority of them will have allele C. So that's the most frequent allele in Great Britain. And again, this can vary between different European populations or between different continental populations as well. But nevertheless, that data is there for you, and it can be easily accessed using the browser. And finally, the other thing I would like to demo is providing, for example, that you would like to export the flanking sequence of this variant with, again, with the choice to select how much you would like to export that sequence with flanking sequence. So that should be under this menu called flanking sequence there. And then you need to configure the page, and then you can customize this to your own needs. So by default, we've got the option to export the sequence with 400 nucleotides, both upstream and downstream. So, but I have the choice or the option to change this as I wish. So according to my example, I wanted 200 nucleotides only, and I do want from both upstream and downstream regions. But again, you may want to change and choose something else. So once I do this, so I did change the configuration there. So I'm going to save and close. So now I do have my variant here, right in the middle, and 200 nucleotide upstream there and downstream here. So my focus variant is in red. And also one thing that you may wonder now, how on earth I've gotten Y there instead of an A, C, or G, or T. So we are, when you come across with things such as Y, R, W, so those are ambiguity codes or IUPAC codes. So instead of providing you with two sequences here, one containing C and the other containing T, in order to save space, we do provide just one sequence, and at that ambiguity position will tell you, it's either C or T, so the ambiguity code is Y. Again, you don't need to memorize those codes. I can show you later how you can, we do have an ambiguity code table within Ensembl, so you can get to that information if you want to. But so here we are. We do have our sequence, 200 nucleotide upstream, 200 nucleotide downstream, and now I can download it. And I've got two options there, either to download this as a faster A format, in case I want to blast it, perhaps, or a rich text format. And according to my demo, this is the option that I wanted. So you can click on here, or you can choose the format from the drop-down menu there, either way. And then again, you can even and further customize the download if you want to, but in this case I don't, and I'll just hit download, and I'll get that downloaded here on my desktop, and then I can open it up, and I can see the marking up being kept there for you. So that can be useful if you want to place primers perhaps, or find out whether or not there are additional variants close by to my focus variant. Okay, so I think that's pretty much of my demo. We can move on to the VEP tool. So the VEP stands for the Variant Effect Predictor. It is a tool within Ensembl created by Ensembl that allows you guys to annotate your own variants. So the original publication of this tool was back in 2010, so you can go back and have a look at the original paper, but we've got more recent papers on this tool as well, and lots of different people all over the world using the VEP and publishing their results as well. So you can annotate your variants, you can annotate your SNPs, you can annotate your CNVs as well. And the VEP is quite powerful in a way that it does accept different input formats. We'll look into those in a minute. And if you are dealing with missense variants, those are variants that cause a change at the amino acid level. So we also have additional tools that allow you to find out whether or not your variant is deleterious. The VEP can be accessed through different ways, through the web interface. If you know Perl, there is a Perl script. And also if you know Ruby, Python, you can also run the VEP using those languages as well. So I'm going to focus on the web interface. Of course, the Perl script is the most powerful one. It can allow you to add plugins and to customize as you wish. But the web interface, nevertheless, is still quite powerful, and especially if you don't have any programmatic skills, so it can be really useful to you guys. So when we talk about annotating variants, so what we're really talking about is placing your variants, mapping your variants along our transcripts. So you may remember from our previous sessions that in Ensembl we do annotate variants and transcripts. So we, in addition to annotating those genes and transcripts, you also fetch the variants from dbSNP, for example, and we map them against our genes and transcripts. And the VEP, in addition to mapping those variants, the VEP allows you to find out the consequences or the classes of variants. So some of the variants may be intronic, they fall into an intronic region, so they will be classified as intronic. Others will fall at the coding region and they may cause a change at the amino acid level, so they will be classified as missense. So there is a lot there for you in terms of classification. You can actually annotate your variants, placing them against our genes and transcripts, but also against other gene sets. So for example, you may be interested in working with the RefSeq gene set, so that's fair enough. So you can run the VEP against those sets, or even better still, you can run against both sets. So you've got that option with the VEP. This is just a summary of some of the consequence terms that you can get with the VEP. Those are not defined by Ensembl. They come from a different consortium called sequence ontology, so they are giving a standard nomenclature for all those variants out there. So as I said, some of them can be intronic, others can fall at the 5' UTR, others are missense, and so on and so forth. So this is the kind of flavor that you can get when you use the Ensembl VEP and when you annotate your own variants. If you're dealing with missense variants, those that cause a change at the amino acid level, in addition to finding where those variants map to, the VEP also provides you guys with a handful of tools that give you an idea how deleterious those missense variants are. So the SIFT and PolyFen are perhaps the widely known prediction tools out there, and they can be shown for you guys on the browser following this traffic light rule. So if you see something red, it just rings the alarm bells that something is probably not quite right. So it's actually a deleterious variant. So you should be cautious regarding that variant. And when you see green, green is good. So again, most of the times, perhaps the two tools will agree, but sometimes it will not. They will not agree. So again, it does highlight there can be discrepancies there on those tools. You would need to perform additional experiments or search for additional tools in order to get a more clear-cut picture of those analyses there. But nevertheless, we do provide them. SIFT is available for all those species there, whereas PolyFem, Condell, and DB and SFP is available for human only. And again, those are different algorithms relying on different aspects of biological data, but all of them are trying to tell you how deleterious a missense variant is. So where can you find the VEP tool? So it's under the Ensembl tools. So you looked at biomath last time, and now we've got the VEP here. So you can just click on that icon here, or you can click on the spanner symbol here. And again, if you want to download the whole script, this is the place to go. Okay, so I've got a few slides now. I may perhaps just do the live demo instead, but perhaps this is the most important one, really. Just to give you guys an idea how the web interface of the VEP looks like. You can run VEP for every single species within Ensembl, and actually your species doesn't even need to be in Ensembl, providing you've got faster files and GTF files for that species, you can use the VEP still. And regarding the different file inputs, so here we are. So we've got what we call Ensembl default, which looks like this. You start with the chromosome location, start and end coordinates, and the two possible alleles, and also the orientation of those alleles, in this case forward. So if you're dealing with SNPs, so SNPs is single nucleotide polymorphism, so the start is equal to the end. You do need to have that number repeated twice. And this is just to highlight that, yeah, you can run the VEP to annotate larger structural variants as well, such as this one. So you just need to know the coordinates, the start and the end coordinates there. Okay, so yeah, there are lots of different output options there for you, in addition to those that tell you how deleterious your missense variant is. We also have now something called LOF tool, so it's loss of function tool, and those are applied for synonymous variants. So yes, there is a SNP there, but the amino acid has not been changed. So again, it can give you an idea of how intolerant perhaps that variant would be. And yeah, so the VEP works on a ticket system. So I'll go through this slide now very quickly. I will demo live. And again, this is just a brief overview of the results and a few of the things that you can do. You can filter as you want, and you can download your table. You can also, which I find really cool, and I will try to demonstrate that, you can connect the VEP results with the BioMart tool as well and get additional information from BioMart. Okay, so this is my tutorial. So let's suppose that I'm a lab scientist and I'm resequencing lots and lots of patient data. So I've got this cohort of data with patients with breast cancer from a local hospital here at Adam Brooks. And those are the positions that I did find. They vary between controls and patients. And those positions are on the previous assembly of the human genome. So I've got here the two possible alleles and for those three different positions there. So I wonder, do any of these cause a change at the amino acid level? Is there any of, are those SNPs, any of them are deleterious? And how can I get the flanking sequence of those variants? So again, we are going to be looking at getting flanking sequence here, but in a different way. So let's see how we can do this. So the clue here, so if I do have genomic coordinates, which is this case, I'm going to be using the Ensembl default format. And this is how you should convert this data into a format that can be read by the VEP tool. So I can bring my VEP tool. It's under tools there. And I'll click on the VEP icon here. And here we are. So this is the online interface of the VEP. But we, if you look carefully, you find out that we are actually looking at the latest assembly, which is GRC-H38, but my coordinates are on the previous assembly, so we do have a warning here. If you do have your coordinates in the previous assembly, we should go to this website instead. So I'm going to click on that one. Here we are. it looks very similar, apart from the banner there, which is purple. Those are the different formats. If you click on them, we'll have an example for each of those. So variant identifiers, things such as RS numbers, or cosmic numbers, and the Ensembl default, which looks like this one. So I'm going to paste in my data. Here we are. So all those variants, if you look back on the demo, they were described on chromosome 9 on the previous assembly. And those are the two possible alleles there. And I've got lots of different things here to explore, so please go ahead and do that at your own time, including predictions regarding how pathogenic the variants can be. So here it's where I can find, for example, the loss of function 2. I'm going to keep the default as they are, and I'll just click on Run. And now the job has been placed in a queue. This queue will get refreshed every 10 seconds or so, and once the job is run successfully, I'll have a green light here. If I do have a problem, I'll get a red light instead, again, following the traffic light system. So hopefully this will not take too long. And again, you've got several options there, such as you can save the results, you can edit your input data, you can share with your favorite colleague or your supervisor, and we can also view the results. So let's click on here. So this is how the results look like for the VEP. So first we do have a table, a summary table, telling me, oh yes, you did have three variants, all of them have been processed, all of them are known. The three variants, they do overlap two different genes and seven different transcripts. And they also fall in a region where a regulatory feature has been annotated. So this is your summary there. So you've got also this nice colorful pie chart that gives you an idea, breakdown of the different consequence terms that come from the sequence ontology consortium. So the majority here are upstream variants. We do have some one-third that do cause a change at the amino acid level, and so on and so forth. And then the second pie chart focuses on coding consequences only. So you have that the majority of them are missense, and one perhaps is causing is not causing a change at the amino acid level. So if you scroll down, so you can see the full table there. You can perhaps filter or sort this table as you wish, let's say according to consequence terms. So now I have all my missense variants here. Again, if you're not too sure what they are, hover over and we should tell you what those terms mean. If you scroll along the table, you will see all sorts of different types of information there for you, including those algorithms that are embedded into VEP, so SIFT and Polyfen. So again, if they are green, the variant is tolerated. If they are red, it's probably damaging or deleterious. So again, those are available just for missense variants. You can also filter. There are several filters that you can apply. But what I'm going to do now, I'm going to connect this table with Biomart. So I would use Biomart now to download the flanking sequence for all those three SNPs there. So I'm going to jump to variants within Biomart. So this is the variation database. Again, GRTH37. My filters are already there. So those are in by default. Just a second. Yeah, so here they are. So they have been automatically placed in the filter for you from the VEP, so that's really, really cool. So the other thing I want to do is just to select my attributes. So I want flanking sequences. I'll come over here, select that option, and then I want, yes, I do want flanking sequence, and I want 200 nucleotide upstream and 200 nucleotide downstream. And again, the last thing I need to do with biomat is just to click on results. And here we are. So I've got my three sequences there from all those three different SNPs. And with the flanking sequence that I have chosen to export from BioMart. So yeah, these are some of the things you can do with the VEP. So you can annotate your variants, you can find out where they map, and what types of consequence they do have. The take-home message of the VEP. The VEP is a tool that can be accessed online or otherwise, and you can annotate your own variants. And the variants of your favorite genome doesn't need to be in Ensembl. That genome doesn't need to be in Ensembl. So I've got a few things to bear in mind in terms of the variation data. You may have noticed I did try to refrain myself from saying the words mutations and polymorphisms, and rather I've been trying to remind myself of saying variants. So unless our variants come from those two databases, we refrain from saying the words mutations. We did cover this, so when you see an allele string such as this one, the first allele is the one on the reference genome. It doesn't mean that's the ancestral, it doesn't mean that's the most frequent one. It may or may not be. And also, Ensembl will report our alleles always on the forward strand. And this can be different from other sources, especially if you're comparing, for example, dbSNP to Ensembl. They may have their alleles on the reverse strand, whereas we do have them always on the forward strand. So those are three important things to keep in mind, if you can. So that's pretty much what I wanted to say today. So again, we are halfway through the series. Next week, we've got Helen. She'll be talking about genes and genomes and how to compare them across our vertebrates and also non-vertebrates. You will see several things, such as how we do create our whole genome alignments and also how you can find gene trees in Ensembl. So this, again, next time, next week, same time, in this webinar series. So the courses should be there for this variation module. So again, go to the URL that you should all be familiar with by now. Again, if you have a chance to do the exercises, it can help you guys to implement what you have heard from me today. If you need help with the exercises, that's what the outreach team is here for. So we really, really, we are very happy when we get questions from you guys. We had earlier today one from BioMart coming on our help desk. So there are different ways that you can send us questions regarding the exercise today. Or perhaps you want to try the VEP with your own data. So you can also, you may want to discuss that with us if you wish so. Those are the usual channels to contact and connect with Ensembl. And that's the whole team there. So again, a big thank you to all of them and also the funders who give us money to perform this amazing research in a way and provide these amazing resources for you guys. So thank you very much for staying until the end and for the questions. And I see you guys next week. Thank you. Bye.